God's scripture this morning is Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and set out, and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up, and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, "Father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham!" And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. Words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We've had some really fun Old Testament readings the last couple of weeks. Next week will be a little less sad. This Old Testament reading is in the lectionary for today, and it's the binding of Isaac. This is a very difficult story for me. The passage and its typical use bear uncomfortable tones of violence and abuse. In her book, The Rock That Is Higher, Story of Truth, Madeline Langle speaks about her encounter with difficult passages. She writes, "A story I found especially troublesome was that of Abraham and Sarah and Isaac. How could a God of love demand the sacrifice of the son he had promised to Abraham and Sarah? What kind of cold-blooded testing was that?" Langle goes on to talk about a completely new exegesis she encountered for this passage when conducting a writer's workshop at Holy Cross Monastery in New York. It is really more a minority viewpoint than a completely new one, though it was undoubtedly new to her. She had assigned a writing project, and one of her students came up after class to tell Langle that she wanted to tell this story from the point of view of God, something Langle had never told the class to do. She goes on, "I laughed. Indeed, it is not a good idea for the finite human being to try to write from the point of view of the infinite God. But I knew that this young woman was well-grounded in scripture, that she was a fine writer, and I trusted her ability to meet a challenge. Go for it, Judith. Write from the point of view of God. The next day, she came in with a dialogue between God and the archangel Raphael, the physician of God. Raphael is very pleased with Abraham's response to God's demand and begins extolling Abraham's virtues to God. And God is not enthusiastic. The more Raphael praises Abraham, the less enthusiastic God gets. Finally, Raphael says, "But God, you put Abraham to the test, and he passed." God replies, "He did not pass. He failed. He chose law over love." This view of the text is held by a minority of interpreters, and to be honest, it's one that resonates with me a great deal more than the Sunday school interpretation of following God's commands over everything else, including our own senses of morality. Everyone hears God's voice differently. And certainly one place we hear it is in our consciousness. Our loves and deep desires and the ways in which we interact with the words we have in Scripture. If someone today attempted to slaughter their child claiming it was a command from God, we would likely assume there was something more going on. Something slightly off. But this story made it into our scriptural canon, no? And it is part of a great web of stories that make up the foundation of our faith. It was formative in Paul's understanding of the meaning of righteousness and great faith. And as I was reading and studying, I found no shortage of commentary on this passage. As a story, it is achingly beautiful. It is concise, well-paced, full of clever literary devices. And reading it with a Christian lens, you can find interesting and compelling parallels to another story of a beloved son climbing a hill with wood on his back. And as Langle again notes, one of the wonders of story is that it is alive, not static. In this case, I read the story of Abraham and Isaac differently now than I did as a child. I read it differently now, as a parent. I suspect that I read this differently because I'm a woman and not a man. I mean, where is Sarah in all of this? This whole story has stood the test of time. And part of the reason it has done so, I think, is because of the dynamic nature of story. Midrash is a form of rabbinic interpretation that attempts to approach difficult passages by filling in the gaps in canonical scripture. Midrash Agadah is really a sort of storytelling, a hermeneutical narrative exploring ethical ideas through biblical characters and ideas that might not be fully fleshed out in the text. The idea of contemporary midrash is somewhat of a contested one. But we can look at Lincoln's retold story of Abraham and Isaac as a sort of contemporary midrash, a new exploration of a difficult text. Critic and professor emeritus Gerald R. Brooms writes, "Midrash illustrates a basic hermeneutical principle, which is that the understanding of a text can never remain simply a state of intellectual agreement with what is said. It is never simply a mental state or the conceptual grasp of the mental state of another. Understanding shows itself only in action in the world. Understanding is only shown in action. The purpose of Scripture is application in the world. I often think about Mr. Rogers when he sees all of the horrible things happening in the world, the devastation, the violence, and his mother says to him, "Look for the helpers." I find myself, especially over the last 3 years, desperately looking for helpers. And when I intentionally look for them, they're always there. One of these places I remember this happening was several years ago during the Black Lives Matter protest in Washington, D.C. Protesters were trapped in the streets following curfew as they were trying to get home. To protect them from arrest, Raul Duby opened his house to 80 protesters. When the police tried to get the protesters to come outside, Duby continued to protect them. The following morning, people in the community began to show up with food and water and hand sanitizer and offered to take people home in their cars. For every time that love wins, how many more times do we choose to stubbornly cling to the comfortable? It is much easier to cling to a set of rules, of predefined standards, than it is to choose love above all else. But God's infinite love and care for God's people, for all of us, is both an invitation and a challenge. It is an invitation for us to accept God's love and grace and salvation, and it is a challenge to share that radical love, grace, and welcome with the world. We have the gift of God's abundant love, a love that fulfills the law, and a love that gives us the freedom and challenge to share this love with the world as we are able. It is our challenge as children of God to choose love as we live in God's abiding love. Thanks be to God. Amen. At this time, I invite our ushers forward for this morning's offering. Let us pray. O God, pour out your Spirit upon these, our gifts, gifts that have been graciously given to us that we now humbly return to you. May they be used to further your kingdom on earth and share your love of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. as we come to our time of prayer this morning, our full prayer list can be found on the back of the bulletin. We want to lift up Chuck and Judy Schaefer this morning. Chuck is in Vanderbilt and not doing well, so we want to lift them up. Nina, do you have a thing? We want to lift them up. Are there any other joys or concerns this morning? One of Doyle's sisters is going to be induced this week, and so we pray for a healthy delivery and baby and mom and family afterwards. And Rosie appears to be very excited. Are there any others? Let us go to God. Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for this day, for this community of people who gather together, committed to sharing your love with the world. Oh God, we lift up to you all of our prayers. Prayers for our world in the midst of violence and unrest. We pray for your unity and peace to wash over the land. We pray for this nation as we continue to wrestle with our complex history. As we continue to long to be people who are seen equally. As we continue to expand our understanding of who belongs. So God, we pray for this community. For the troubles it faces, for the joys and celebrations it has. Oh God, continue to be with us. Continue to strengthen us as we live out your call on our lives. God, we also lift up to you the deepest prayers of our hearts. The ones that aren't ready to be spoken aloud. The ones that are still beyond words. May we find your comfort and peace, your love and your understanding. May we be reminded that we are invited to rest in you, that we might find protection and comfort and peace in you. Oh God, continue to strengthen us. Continue to show your presence among us as we strive to show your love to this community, to this nation, to this world. We offer you our prayers and give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we come to our time of Holy Communion, we are reminded that this is not our table. This is not St. B's table. This is not the United Methodist Church's table. This is God's table. Christ invites you to this table no matter what. This morning, we'll be taking communion at the altar. Our ushers will guide you forward and you're invited to kneel, and our servers will serve you the bread and the cup. Any money that is left on the altar goes to our Helping Hands Fund, which goes to assist our neighbors in need. You will also notice that there are some prepackaged elements at the front. Those will be going with Nita to Guatemala. We will be blessing them today as part of our communion liturgy. And as we come forward to receive communion, I invite you to say a prayer over these elements, over Nita and for her team, so that they know that St. B's prayers are going with them all those miles away. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love, and we have not heard your prayers, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, our Alpha and our Omega, whose strong and loving arms encompass the universe. For with your eternal word and Holy Spirit, you are forever one God. Through your word, you created all things and called them good. And in you, we live and move and have our being. When we fell into sin, you did not desert us. You made covenant with your people, Israel, and spoke through prophets and teachers. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Christ, who called you Abba, Father. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embrace a people as your own and fill them with a longing for a peace that would last and a justice that would never fail. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus, who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you do this, do so in remembrance of me." When supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, that we may know in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this wine, we know the presence of the living God and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood. As the grain and grapes once dispersed in the fields are now united on this table in bread and wine, so may we and all your people be gathered from every time and place into the unity of your eternal household and feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Because there is one loaf, we who are many partake in the sharing of one loaf. The bread which we break is the sharing of the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is sharing in the blood of Christ. At this time, I invite those assisting with table is set and you are invited.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. This morning, before we get to our closing hymn, we are going to be praying over Nita on her trip to Guatemala. Dear friends, as we take part in this celebration of blessing and commissioning, we are reliving a practice of the early church. We read in the book of Acts that the Holy Spirit set apart Saul and Barnabas for the work of mission, and the church of Antioch, after fasting and prayer, laid hands on them and sent them out. The early church eagerly sent its members to other peoples, to assist those who are already of the household of faith and those who do not yet believe in Christ. Today, we also send our sister, Nita, to serve the needs of the church throughout the world. This commissioning and sending will strengthen the bonds we maintain with the faith-filled communities to which she is going. And the prayers we offer are an expression of the ties that bind us together in the larger body of Christ. Nita, I ask you, will you earnestly seek to carry forward your ministry in sincerity and love, cooperating humbly with your co-workers under the direction of the church? Friends, at this time, we are going to have Nita kneel at the altar, and you are invited, as you are able, to come forward and lay hands on her. If you are not able to come forward, please extend your hand out from yourself. Please come forward. As we pray for Nita, we also remember the team with whom she will be working. Let us pray. Almighty God, source of all mercies, graciously behold this your servant, now to be commissioned as a missionary of your church. Endow Nita with your Spirit, enrich her with your heavenly grace, and strengthen her for the tasks which lie ahead, that in all her works, begun, continued, and ended in you, she may glorify your holy name and advance your blessed work. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Nita, I commission you to take the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ into all the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'll get back. Now, as you return to your seats, I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing together the summons in the Faith We Sing 2130. Thank you. luggage that is attempting to get from the United States in Atlanta all the way to Guatemala City. Though Nina is being sent out for mission to Guatemala this week, we are all sent out for mission in our community. And as we go, may we always choose love above all else. And so, go in peace, in the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer. Amen.
I'm going to start here, Friday. It's very easy.